Hi guys, gals, and non-binary pals. We're back today with chapter 16, Silverweed. "Well done," said Hazel, as Dandelion ended. "He's very good, isn't he?" said Silver. "We're lucky to have him with us. It raises your spirits just to hear him." "That's put their ears flat for them," whispered Bigwig. "Let's just see them find a storyteller to beat him." They were all in no doubt that Dandelion had done them credit. Ever since their arrival, most of them had felt out of their depth among these magnificent, well-fed strangers, with their detached manners, their shapes on the wall, their elegance, their adroit evasion of almost all questions, above all, their fits of unrabbit-like melancholy. Now, their own storyteller had shown that they were no mere bunch of tramps. Certainly, no reasonable rabbit could withhold admiration. They waited to be told as much, but after a few moments realized with surprise that their hosts were evidently less enthusiastic. "Very nice," said Cowslip. He seemed to be searching for something more to say, but then repeated, "Yes, very nice. An unusual tale." "But he must know it, surely," muttered Blackberry to Hazel. "I always think these traditional stories retain a lot of charm," said another of the rabbits, "especially when they're told in the real old-fashioned spirit." "Yes," said Strawberry. "Conviction." "That's what it needs. You really have to believe in Elephrera and Prince Rainbow, don't you? Then all the rest follows." "Don't say anything, Bigwig," whispered Hazel, for Bigwig was scuffling his paws indignantly. "You can't force them to like it if they don't. Let's wait and see what they can do themselves." Aloud, he said, "Our stories haven't changed in generations, you know. After all, we haven't changed ourselves. Our lives have been the same as our fathers and their fathers before them. Things are different here. We realize that. And we think your new ideas and ways are very exciting. We're all wondering what kind of things you tell stories about." "Well, we don't tell the old stories very much," said Cowslip. "Our stories and poems are mostly about our own lives here. Of course, that shape of laburnum that you saw, that's old-fashioned now. Elephrera doesn't really mean much to us. Not that your friend's story wasn't very charming," he added hastily. "Elephrera is a trickster," said Buckthorn, "and rabbits will always need tricks." "No," said a new voice from the further end of the hall beyond Cowslip. "Rabbits need dignity, and above all, the will to accept their fate." Ominous. "We think Silverweed is one of the best poets we've had for many months," said Cowslip. "His ideas have a great following. Would you like to hear him now?" "Yes, yes," said voices from all sides. "Silverweed!" "Hazel," said Fiver suddenly, "I want to get a clear idea of this Silverweed, but I daren't go closer by myself. Will you come with me?" "Why, Fiver, whatever do you mean? What is there to be afraid of?" "Oh, Frith, help me," said Fiver, trembling. "I can smell him from here. He terrifies me." "Oh, Fiver, don't be absurd. He just smells the same as the rest of them. He smells like barley rained down and left to rot in the fields. He smells like a wounded mole that can't get underground. He smells like a big fat rabbit to me with a lot of carrots inside, but I'll come with you." When they had edged their way through the crowd to the far end of the burrow, Hazel was surprised to realize that Silverweed was a mere youngster. In the Sandalford Warren, no rabbit of his age would have been asked to tell a story, except perhaps to a few friends alone. He had a wild, desperate air, and his ears twitched continually. As he began to speak, he seemed to grow less and less aware of his audience, and continually turned his head, as though listening to some sound, audible only to himself, from the entrance tunnel behind him. But there was an arresting fascination in his voice, like the movement of wind and light on a meadow, and as its rhythm entered into his hearers, the whole burrow became silent. "The wind is blowing, blowing over the grass. It shakes the willow catkins, the leaves shine silver. Where are you going, wind? Far, far away. Over the hills, over the edge of the world. Take me with you, wind, high over the sky. I will go with you. I will be rabbit of the wind. Into the sky, the feathery sky and the rabbit, The stream is running, running over the gravel. Through the brock lime, the kingcups, the blue and the gold of spring. Where are you going, stream? Far, far away. Beyond the heather, sliding all away all night. Take me with you, stream, away in the starlight. I will go with you. I will be rabbit of the stream. Down through the water, the green water and the rabbit. In autumn the leaves come blowing, yellow and brown. They rustle in the ditches, they tug and hang on the hedge. Where are you going, leaves? Far, far away. Into the earth we go, with the rain and the berries. Take me, leaves, oh, take me on your dark journey. I will go with you, I will be rabbit of the leaves, in the deep places of the earth and the rabbit. Frith lies in the evening sky, the clouds are red about him. I am here, Lord Frith, I am running through the long grass. Oh, take me with you, dropping behind the woods, far away to the light, to the heart of light, the silence. For I am ready to give you breath, my breath, my life, the shining circle of the sun and the rabbit. Fiverr, as he listened, had shown a mixture of intense absorption and incredulous horror. At one and the same time, he seemed to accept every word, and yet to be stricken with fear. Once he drew in his breath, as though startled to recognize his own half-known thoughts, and when the poem was ended, he seemed to be struggling to come to himself. He bared his teeth and licked his lips, as Blackberry had done before the dead hedgehog on the road. A rabbit in fear of an enemy will sometimes crouch stock still, either fascinated or else trusting to its natural inconspicuousness to remain unnoticed. But then, unless the fascination is too powerful, there comes the point when keeping still is discarded, and the rabbit, as though breaking a spell, turns in an instant to its other resource, flight. So it seemed to be with Fiverr now. Suddenly he leaped up and began to push his way violently across the great burrow. Several rabbits were jostled and turned angrily on him, but he took no notice. Then he came to a place where he could not push between two heavy worn bucks. He became hysterical, kicking and scuffling, and Hazel, who was behind him, had difficulty in preventing a fight. "My brother's a sort of poet, too, you know," he said to the bristling strangers. "Things affect him very strongly sometimes, and he doesn't always know why." One of the rabbits seemed to accept what Hazel had said, but the other replied, "Oh, another poet? Let's hear him, then. That'll be some return for my shoulder, anyway." He scratched a great tuft of fur out. Fiverr was already beyond them and thrusting toward the further entrance tunnel. Hazel felt that he must follow him, but after all the trouble that he himself had taken to be friendly, he felt so cross at the way in which Fiverr had antagonized their new friends that he had passed Bigwig, he said, "Come and help me get some sense into him. The last thing we want is a fight now." He felt that Fiverr really deserved a short touch of Bigwig. They followed Fiverr up the run and overtook him at the entrance. Before either of them could say a word, he turned and began to speak as though they had asked him a question. "You felt it, then? And you want to know whether I did? Of course I did. That's the worst part of it. There isn't any trick. He speaks the truth. So, as long as he speaks the truth, it can't be folly. That's what you're going to say, isn't it? I'm not blaming you, Hazel. I felt it myself, moving towards him like one cloud drifting into another. But then at the last moment, I drifted wide. Who knows why? It wasn't my own will. It was an accident. There was just some little part of me that carried me wide of him. Did I say the roof of that hall was made of bones? No, it's like a great mist of folly that covers the whole sky, and we shall never see it, and we shall never see to go by Frith's light any more. Oh, what will become of us? A thing can be true and still be desperate folly, Hazel."
"What on earth's all this?" said Hazel to Bigwig in perplexity.
He's talking about that lop-eared nitwit of a poet down there," answered Bigwig. "I know that much. But why he seems to think we should want to have anything to do with him and his fancy talk, that's more than I can imagine. You can save your breath, Fiverr. The only thing that's bothering us is this row you've started. As for Silverweed, all I can say is I'll keep Silver, and he can be just plain weed."
Fiverr gazed back at him with eyes like a fly's, seemed larger than his head. "You think that," he said. "You believe that, but each of you, in his own way, is thick in that mist. Where is the..." Hazel interrupted him as he did so, and as he did so, Fiverr started. "Fiverr, I won't pretend that I didn't follow you up here to speak angrily. You've endangered our good start in this warren." "Endangered?" cried Fiverr. "Endangered? Why, the whole place..." "Be quiet. I was going to be angry, but you're obviously so much upset that it would be pointless. But what you are going to do now is come underground with the two of us and sleep. Come on. And don't say any more for the moment." One respect in which rabbits' lives are less complicated than those of humans is that they are not ashamed to use force. Having no alternative, Fiverr accompanied Hazel and Bigwig to the burrow where Hazel had spent the previous night. There was no one there, and they lay down and slept. All right, and that's it. Thanks for listening, everyone. Bye.